Father, it's time to share your word with your people. Lord, I pray that you let my lips and my mouth and you open the ears of your people to hear your word in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That the entrance of your word may bring light and give understanding to the simple.
Amen.
Let your word today bless us.
Amen.
Let your word today enrich us.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We thank the Lord God for this day. We thank God for creating us and even making us in His own image. Him that loving us so much that He gave His breath of life and breathed it into man and made us whole today. All glory, honor, and adoration to His name. On behalf of the youth ministry, I want to appreciate the church and the authorities of the church in that they have deemed it fit that once a quarter gave an opportunity for the youth to lead the service of the Lord's people. We pray that the wisdom that God has given unto them will not fade in Jesus' name.
Amen.
There is a Yoruba proverb that says, well, I'll say it in English, that when the elephant trumpets, that the elephant's kids shouldn't trumpet at the same time. But then that proverb has been sort of comically giving a very good response. That it is good for the child of the elephant to also trumpet when the elephant is there. So that when just in case the child of the elephant sings some discordant tune, the elephant will be there to correct the child. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Many years ago, probably about 6 or 7 years now, the current chairman of the church, Honorary Monsignor Evangelist Adeino, was at the youth ministry and was teaching and telling us some very, very important things. And after then, he actually said that he was going to come to church to deliver that same message to the church, but I think there was no opportunity for him to do that. Today, since the lessons we'll be dealing with today, we'll be talking about the same thing, talking about commitment to obedience. Our commitment to obedience. Because there must be a commitment for us to know the will to serve God, you must obey His will. And for you to know the will of God, you must actively try to seek the will of God. And there must be a commitment to obedience. There are instructions that God has given unto us to follow, and we must be committed to follow these instructions. And he said he sort of had a revelation about our prayers, especially our three members' prayers. That it was like when there is a three member, when we're praying, there are specific angels that are there sitting, listening to our prayers. Take it up to our Father and heed to our prayers. Right from the beginning of the service, our instructions and our order of service has been put in place, written down black and white. The beginning, the service conductor, the first prayer, he will pray for forgiveness of sins. The second prayer, he will pray for thanksgiving. Specifically, only thanksgiving, only forgiveness of sins. And it would come to three members' prayer. It said that the first person should pray for spiritual power and progress. It said, and as the first person is praying, the angel is there just dishing out the answers to the prayers. The second person should pray specifically for victory and protection. And the third will pray for blessing and God's favor. These are instructions that were given from God and written black and white for us to read. And when the service conductor reads out these prayer points, it's not because he decides to just fathom these things from his head or just read it out. They were instructions given from God. And when we, as God's children, decide in our own wisdom to deviate from these instructions, we are not following His principles. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So when they ask you to pray for spiritual power and progress, and then you pray for blessing, you are going outside of the laid down laws. When they say the female should pray for victory and protection, and it's that time that you want to pray for the things that are in your heart, you are not following laid down laws. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We are not wiser than God. There was a reason why He gave these things. And then you have an opportunity to pray to God, open your heart to Him in your silent prayer. Everything is complete. Everything has been set down. It is for us to commit in obedience. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Moving on from that, again the chairman then, when he was in the youth ministry, will remind us. And he stresses on that part a lot. Says that we are special people. Constantly reminds us that we are special people. 1 Peter 2:9 says, we are a holy generation, God's own priesthood, His own special people. And he sort of correlates it to his own life, where he was coming from, and what God has made him today. Hallelujah. Reminding us that we are special before God. And we all here today, we are special before God. And these lessons that were read to us were lessons of instructions that God has given to the parents of His own special people. Specific, cogent instructions on how the parents of these children will raise them. On Wednesday, by the grace of God, we will come together and we'll have a christening. And there will be a prophet that will stand in the gap and listen from heaven and give instructions from heaven to the parents of the child. That this is how the boy's life will be. This is what he should do. This is what he shouldn't do. In the case of Samson and John, the message was given even before they were conceived. And it is the duty of the parents to make sure that the instructions that God has given, there is no deviation from it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Luke 1:16.
And many of the children of Israel.
Yes.
Shall he turn to the Lord their God?
Continue. Now, this is the rule of the life of John. He will go before him, yes?
In the spirit and power of Elias.
Yes?
Turn the hearts of the fathers to the children.
To turn the hearts of the fathers to the children.
And the disobedient to the wisdom of the just.
And the hearts of the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, yes?
To make ready a people prepared for the Lord.
To make ready a people that are prepared for God.
And Zechariah said unto the angel.
That's it, thank you. That was John's own specific purpose in life. To turn the hearts of the children that are lost to their parents. Those who are disobedient, to bring them back into wisdom of the just. Judges chapter 13, verse 5. Judges 13:5, yes.
For lo,
yes.
Thou shalt conceive.
You will conceive.
And bear a son.
There will be a son.
And no razor shall come upon his head.
For the child shall be a Nazarite. This child is different. He shall be a Nazarite, yes.
Unto God from the womb.
Aha.
And he shall begin to deliver Israel.
He will begin to deliver Israel.
Out of the hands of the Philistines.
Out of the hands of the Philistines. Thank you. That was Samson's own specific purpose. Because the first verse of the lesson, Judges 13, says that again the children of God disobeyed God, and God handed them over to the Philistines, and they began to do them as they wished. At that time, it was a very, very terrible thing for you to fall into the hands of your enemies. At a point in David's life, God gave him three options. You have offended me, what do you want me to do for you? Option A, I give you over to your enemies. Option B, illness will come upon the land. And David thought, he was like, you know what? These options are very difficult. Let me fall into your hands. Your mercies are enough for me. Hallelujah. And the children of Israel up to that point was suffering from the hands of the Philistines. And Samson's own purpose was that he would come to deliver them from the hands of the Philistines. But then there was a very special message that was common between both chapters and both lessons. Was that these two children, even from the womb, that the mother should not drink alcohol, any strong drink touch their mouth. And the parents also to make sure that these children do not drink alcohol or eat any unclean things. Because God has separated them for a purpose. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And so it was. But it wouldn't be the first time that God is promising or saying that someone should drink alcohol. Some may argue that alcohol won't kill you. Food for the stomach. At least he sometimes enriches or does one or two things. But God has a specific purpose for everybody. There was a reason why he told them not to drink alcohol. There was a reason why he purposely told them that, look, these children are separate. Separate them. They have been given a specific purpose that I want to send them into the world. For Samson, he was in Nazareth. Even no razor should touch his head. He had once told Aaron and his children that to make sure that they do not drink alcohol. I think it's in Leviticus 10 from verse 8. If anyone sees it, let's read.
And the Lord spake unto Aaron.
Yes.
Saying, do not drink wine.
You will not drink wine.
Nor strong drink.
Nor any strong drink.
Thou nor thy sons with thee.
Neither you nor your sons with you, yes.
When you go into the tabernacle,
yes?
Yes, lest ye die.
If you do that, you will die, yes?
It shall be a statute forever throughout your
generations. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I said, God doesn't give, he knows, he has a reason for every purpose. For everything, there is a reason for him doing it. You'll still continue reading, Sarah, just stand up. There is a reason for him giving you an instruction. He just doesn't do it for just no reason. There is a purpose for it. Because Aaron had a special purpose. He was a Levite. And his own was to minister unto the people. Continue verse 11.
And that he may teach the children.
Because as a minister of God, as ministry to the people, he cannot be in a state of mind that is not sin. He said that you may distinguish between what? Between holy and unholy. Yes? 11.
And that ye may teach the children.
That you may teach the children, yes?
All
these statutes that I'm giving you.
The Lord has spoken.
Yes.
By the hand of Moses.
Yes.
And Moses spake unto Aaron.
Hallelujah. That you may distinguish between holy and unholy. That you may distinguish between clean and unclean. Because a drunk man is not of a sane mind. A drunk man acts foolishly. Because you have been given a higher office, you cannot then act stupidly or foolishly. Because you have been separated for a special purpose that God is sending you into the world, you cannot act foolishly. Lot After making some goods and he conquered and his children, two of them, two girls, they said, according to the Bible, they said there were no man to marry them. And then they decided between themselves, Genesis, I think it's in Genesis 19. They decided between themselves, the two girls, that, you know what, let us make our father drunk. It seems there is no man coming to ask for our hand in marriage. Let's just make our father drunk. And they served him wine. And he drank and he was drunk. Genesis 19:30-31. The first child, the first one that said unto the younger one, yes.
Our father is old.
Our father is old.
And there is not a man in the earth.
There is no man for them to marry, yes.
Come unto us.
Yes.
After the manner of all the earth.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Let us make our
father
drink wine.
Let us give this guy some drink, yes.
And we will lie with him.
And we will lie with him.
That we may preserve seed of our father.
That we may preserve seed of our father. That's the Lot's own children, his own daughters. Yes, continue.
And they made their father drink wine.
And they made their father drink wine.
And the first one went in.
The first one went in.
And lay with her father.
And Lot lay with his own daughter. He didn't even know because he was drunk. Yes?
And he perceived not when she lay.
He didn't know when she lay down and when she stood up. Continue.
But when she arose.
Yes.
And came to
pass. Yes.
In the morrow.
Uh-huh.
That the first one
reported the situation to the younger one. Yes.
Behold.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Let us make him drink wine.
Let us give him another round of wine today. Yes.
And go down here.
Uh-huh.
And lie with him.
Yes.
That they may preserve seed of our father.
That they may preserve seed of their father. Yes.
And they made their father drink wine that night.
Again, they gave the father some round of wine. Yes.
And the younger arose.
And the younger went in.
And lay with him.
Mm-hmm.
And perceived not when she lay.
Yes.
And not when she arose.
Yes. Continue. Yes. Then both of them had children, yes.
Shout by their father.
Uh-huh.
And the first one
bare
a son.
The first one had a son.
And called his name Moab.
And called his name Moab.
And the same the father of the Moabites
unto
this day.
That same Moab is the father of the Moabites up to this day, yes?
And the younger
one had a son.
He also
bare
a son.
Yes.
Called his name
Ben-Ammon. Yes, Ammon, yes. The same is the father of the Ammonites up to this day. Incest. Because they had given their father very good, probably red wine to drink. Hallelujah. And he was drunk. Because God has given you a purpose. He has placed you in a higher office. You cannot then act foolishly. Noah had built the ark. The flood had come and gone. He gave thanks to God. He was happy. God had saved him and his children and their wives. And Noah was a farmer and he built a vine and he was happy. There's nothing wrong with being happy. Genesis 9, from verse 20. Noah was a farmer, yes.
And he planted a vineyard.
He planted a vineyard.
And he drank of the wine.
He said the laborer shall be the first partaker of the fruit. So he was he's a husbandman and he grew his own wine and he drank of it. He's the first partaker, yes.
And he was drunk.
And Noah drank so much that he was drunk.
And he was uncovered within his tent.
And he was naked. He was naked, acted foolishly, he was naked, yes.
And Ham.
And Ham.
The father of Canaan.
The father of Canaan. Please, let's pay attention. The father of Canaan, yes.
Who saw the nakedness of his father.
Ham saw the nakedness of his father.
And told his two brethren with
that. And then again, the death of the father went to tell his two brothers, Shem and Japheth, yes. And the other wiser children, two of them, then took a garment upon their shoulders, yes?
And laid it upon their shoulders.
Uh-huh.
And went backwards.
Yes.
And covered the nakedness of their father.
And covered the nakedness of their father.
And their faces were backwards.
Their faces were backwards.
And they saw not their
father. They didn't see their father's nakedness. Yes, continue.
And Noah awoke from his wine.
When Noah was then sober, he awoke from his drunkenness. Yes.
And he was his younger son had done unto him.
Yes.
And he said,
Cursed be Canaan.
A servant of servants.
He will be a servant of servants. He shall be this to his brethren.
And he said,
Blessed be the Lord God of shame.
And Canaan shall be his servant.
And may Canaan be his servant. May God enlarge Japheth.
And he shall dwell in the tent of shame.
And may he dwell in the tent of shame.
And Canaan shall be his servant.
And may Canaan be his servant. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Noah was drunk. First wrong. Ham then made jest of his father. Second wrong. They say two wrongs don't make you right. Noah woke up, and the thing he did was he cursed. He didn't curse Ham. He cursed his generation. He said Ham was the father of Canaan. He cursed his generation. Abraham, many, many years later, will tell his chief servant to hold his thigh and swear unto him that he will not take any wife from the daughters of Canaan for my son Isaac. Genesis 24. Noah had cursed Canaan. God's promise, God's lineage would not be filtered. The curse that Noah had placed on Canaan was there. Isaac was a child of promise. He would not come from the lineage of Canaan. Because Noah had cursed Canaan. Yes, 24. Verse.
And I make him swear.
Yes, swear by his servant, yes.
By the Lord.
By the Lord.
The God of heaven.
Yes.
And the God of the earth.
Uh-huh.
That thou shalt not take a wife.
Yes.
Unto my son.
Yes.
Of the daughters of the Canaan.
Of the daughters of the Canaan. That's okay, thank you. Hallelujah.
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 Noah was a husband man and a drunk wife. That was the genesis of the whole problem. His son Ham to act very stupidly. And there are two lessons here for the youth. The fact that sometimes your parents may misbehave does not give you any right whatsoever to dishonor them. I repeat. The fact that your parents at some point may misbehave does not give you any right whatsoever to dishonor them. Noah misbehaved. Shem and Japheth didn't dishonor him. And they were blessed. The same wasn't the case for Ham. He was cursed. The children, obey your parents in the Lord. Honor your father and your mother. For this is right. It's the first commandment we promise. It says that it may be well with you and you may live long on earth. Ephesians 6. And he turned to the fathers. He said, Fathers, you too, you have a responsibility. Do not provoke your children to wrath. Every one of us has a responsibility. Both to parents and to the children. God sent angel Gabriel to Zechariah, the father of John. This is your responsibility. You have to make sure that you bring up this child in the way of the Lord. This is what he's going to be in life. Do not eat anything unclean. Do not drink alcohol, because the Holy Spirit will be, even from the womb, the Holy Spirit will be with you. To the parents. He went to the mother of Samson, that this is what Samson will be like. Make sure that this and this and this doesn't happen to him. Hallelujah.
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 You can see what God is doing in the family. Holding the family together. Even when Manoah, when the wife of the mother of Samson, went to tell Manoah what the angel had said, he prayed. He said, "Lord, let me also hear what you have told my wife." When the angel came again, he asked. The angel said, "The same thing I have told your wife. That is what you should do." And he said, "It's no more than that." His father and the mother. Same instruction given to Zechariah. Every nation, any nation you see, any community you see, the foundation of that community is the family. As a church that we are sat here, is an aggregation of various families. We have many families in this place. There's one lady, one of our members here, they call her Odoria, be the head of the family. She's the head of our own family. Hallelujah. We have the Shebioba family, we have the Ayade family, we have the Zikel family, we have the Ayere family, we have the Washigua family, we have all plenty families. It's a coalition of various families. And God was giving specific instructions to each family in both lessons. And if the devil will want to infiltrate, it will go into these families. If the devil wants to destroy the church, I mean not Christ as a body, but us here, it will go into different families and begin to infiltrate and cause havoc. And when this happens, by the time it grows and continues to grow, before you know what, there is danger everywhere. Hallelujah. So it is our responsibility as parents and children to do all we can, to pray as hard as we can, to work as hard as we can, that the devil doesn't infiltrate our families. As parents, we even have a greater responsibility. Because if these instructions of God to the children, because the child, when he was, she's a baby, they cannot hear but see or see. It is the parent that hears the instruction from God. And for every instruction that God has given concerning your child, it is your duty to make sure that these instructions are followed. If you have forgotten, like Manoah, ask God to bring back the message. Manoah wasn't there when the message was given to his wife. He prayed unto God that, "God, please come back again and let me hear this message." It's our duty to make sure that families are kept intact. And in doing so, sometimes we sort of like kick ourselves in the foot. Paul said in Corinthians, he said, "I would advise you," 1 Corinthians 7, "I would advise you that you shouldn't marry. Because the person that marries, all your mind is how you're going to please your wife or your husband. But if you're not married, you only want to please God." Hallelujah. He was very, very pragmatic. But then we only have 24 hours in a day. The place or hours or number of hours that you spend in specific place will determine what happens afterwards. If you spend the rest, whole of your day in church, 24 hours in church, every day, and you are married, you rest assured that your family gets zero. And if your family gets zero, God will ask you, "Is this what I asked you to do?" Jesus in Matthew 19 was saying, some people have been called as eunuchs. Their own is to have no family whatsoever. Theirs is to serve in the presence of God. He said some people even call themselves to be eunuchs. And once you've made that commitment, you're separated. But if you have a family, God didn't ask you to come here to sleep here and then neglect your family. I'll tell you a story. I can say with due respect to every father or parent here that my father is the best father on earth. And he was a man who was so committed to his work, to the work of God. In that he spent many hours in the house of God. But then there was a year that I was ill and I was taken into the hospital. I think I was there for about a week. And then I saw him the first day. It was during Easter. It was the Easter period. And Easter period, that is a very, very busy time. That there's a lot of activities in church. I saw him the first day and some days later, I didn't see him anymore because obviously he was in church. And then one of the days that my mom was visiting, I asked her that, where is daddy? I can't remember what response she gave me that day, but the next day I saw him. So something must have happened by the time she got home. Hallelujah. But then as a child, all I wanted at that point was to see my father as I was on that bed ill. But then he had commitment. But that commitment doesn't give him a right to neglect his family. As a father, if you spend 20 hours outside, your family only gets 4. You cannot get more than 24 hours in a day. It means that your wife gets 4. It means that your children get even less. And like a cancer, the doctors will tell you, it infiltrates. You don't see it the first day. It carries on over and over many years. And then when it gets to the stage 4, it will be too late by then. Hallelujah. These are the things that we unconsciously do to ourselves. In my case of my father, I just pray that I thank God for his grace upon them, that even though he was extremely committed to work, God was still helping him out in the areas of the family to make sure that things don't get haywire. Hallelujah. But we have all have responsibilities. As a wife, if you're not fully committed to your husband, then you don't give him a... Sometimes, for our men, all they need is just to sit down and look at your face. Just to have you in the house. Your children, God's so good, in this part of the world, even if you don't give them money, the government will give them money. Sometimes they don't even need your money. They only need you to put them right in the way of the Lord. They only need you to take them to the park. They only need you to do their homework with them. They only need you to play with them. They only need you to just teach them the word of God. Encourage them. Give them the word of God. God has given them an instruction that they shouldn't do this or that. Teach them in that way. That's all they need you to do. Just a bit of your time. But then, in the situation that we have, people go out Monday to Friday, come back home, the kids train and asleep and things like that. And then Saturday comes, you're busy doing chores, and then Sunday comes, you spend the whole day in church. Your family is being neglected. Family life gradually disintegrates. When they came and they said that, okay, that we should finish at 1:30, it wasn't because people don't like to spend time in church, or because we don't want to stay in the presence of God. But there are reasons why these things are. And it's our duty, because God will ask you. If you neglect your family, God will ask you. We are busy chasing one thing or the other. And there's nothing wrong in doing that. There's nothing wrong in chasing our careers. There's nothing wrong in chasing our lives or what it is. But then it shouldn't be at the detriment of our families. Because that should come first. And if you're sitting there thinking that yes, or you have everything right, or you give the right amount to your family, don't mock others. You don't have any right to judge others because you don't see the full picture of what they are going through. You have no right to judge anybody whose family or life is not properly online. You have no right to do that. Because only God knows and sees them, because they have a sincerity of heart to do what they are doing. Like my father, he was so committed that he didn't even know that at some point that his family was being neglected, even though he was 100% committed to the work of God. And I pray for every such family that healing will come in Jesus' name. Amen. I pray for every family going through any turbulence that healing will come in Jesus' name. Amen. I pray for even those who are yet to go into such turbulence, that our Father will come through for you in Jesus' name. Yeah. Luke chapter 1, 6-7.
And they were both righteous before God.
Zechariah and Elizabeth were righteous before God.
Walking in all the commandments.
They were walking in the commandments of God.
And ordinances of the Lord.
And ordinances of God, yes.
And they had no child.
But they had no child.
Because that Elizabeth was barren.
Elizabeth was barren. Hallelujah. That was the old but in their family. Even though both of them were righteous and doing God's work and believing God, there was a but in their family that they had no child. I don't know what but is that is in your own family. But the same God who came through for Zechariah and Elizabeth will come through for you in Jesus' name. Yeah. As we said, that the family, every one of us here is an aggregation of each family. We pray for every family, every single family in this church, that our Father will heal us in Jesus' name. Yeah. Luke 1:13.
But the angel said unto
Zechariah,
"Do
not fear, yes?
For thy prayer is heard.
Your prayers are heard.
And thy wife Elizabeth."
Hallelujah. Your prayers are heard. For everyone crying internally, weeping every night, praying to God for one reason or the other. For anyone asking God for one thing, even for a child, asking God, "I just want peace in my family." Asking God, "I just want healing in my family." Asking God, "I just want you to sort this out for me." Your prayers are heard.
Yeah.
Luke 1:19.
And the angel answered and said, "I am Gabriel."
Gabriel declared himself before Zechariah. He said, "It is same me that stands in the presence of God.
And I'm sent to speak of
you. And I have given you this good news that you will have a son. Your prayers have been heard." The Lord is declaring himself to you today that in whatever situation you are going through, in whatever illness that you are going through, that your prayers are heard in Jesus' name. Yeah. There's a song that says, "Iroya Yonimoko
Angeli Gabriel Sofoni Oko 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 Oko."
He said, "I heard the voice that Angel Gabriel is saying to me. I heard the voice from heaven that saying that my own case is successful. It has now turned into joy." Amen. That will be your case in Jesus' name. Yeah. Ahim says, "Abarani mi mawole, abarani mi wole, Jesu wole, ayo wole, abarani mi mawole, abarani mi wole." Thank you.
that Jesus has come in, joy has come in. And it's a prayer that joy will come into every household here in the mighty name of Jesus. And so shall it be. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.